Over the last 8 years, I've performed 37 full-length reviews on keyboards, or at least typing devices in some form or another. What I didn't realize until later is that there's an entire subculture dedicated to the customization, and more accurately, the personalization of mechanical keyboards. Now, I've replaced keycaps and hot-swapped a few switches, but by comparison, I've merely dipped my toes into the proverbial personalized PC peripheral pool. Eclipse Team, a manufacturer of mechanical keyboards and parts, offered to help me build one by providing most of the components you'll see today. So come with me as I dive headfirst into the deep end of custom mechanical keyboards. Like I mentioned, Eclipse Team supplied most of the parts for this project. There are a few tools and accessories I picked up from Amazon as well. By no means are they required, but they definitely simplify the process. Links to Eclipse Team's website, affiliate links to Amazon, and links to pick up these awesome shirts from Retro Rifle can be found in the description below. For the uninitiated, mechanical keyboards use some variety of spring-loaded mechanical switch. These differ from cheaper and more common membrane keyboards that often use a rubber dome. While there are many mechanical switch variations out there, most of them can trace their lineage back to the MX design, originally patented by computer hardware company Cherry in 1984. Cherry MX switches had market supremacy for decades until their patent expired in 2014. This allowed other manufacturers to compete in the space, bringing cheaper alternatives with greater variation and improvements to Cherry's original design. While mechanical keyboards are more expensive to manufacture than their membrane counterparts, they typically last much longer. In addition to improved longevity, most people prefer the more tactile noise and typing feel they provide. A typical mechanical keyboard is comprised of roughly six major parts: a PCB, case, backplate, switches, keycaps, and USB cable. While some mechanical keyboards don't allow any customization, even going as far as to leverage a proprietary switch stem to ensure no other keycaps can be used, others, like the Eclipse Team EC66, allow you to customize just about everything. This board can be purchased pre-built for around $100, or you can piece out everything yourself to maximize the customization potential. If you add everything up, it was around $160 to personalize. The biggest surprise to custom keyboard newcomers is the cost of entry. $160 may sound like a lot, but that's honestly about as cheap as you can expect to build one. The median price for a custom board is around the $300 to $500 mark, but at the elite end of the spectrum, it's possible for a board to pass $1,000. If this is your first custom keyboard, I recommend not spending anywhere near that. When shopping for parts, it's important to understand that there are many variations of each component. While keycap switches and USB cables are largely standardized, backplates, cases, and PCBs require more research to ensure compatibility. The brain of the keyboard is the PCB, or printed circuit board. Its job is to connect all of the inputs to a microprocessor that monitors each key and send that information to the computer. These are sold either as a single unit or as part of a kit. PCBs are historically green with gold circuitry, but this one has been painted white to match the rest of the board. The first thing to consider when picking a PCB is what size keyboard you want. I linked a nifty keyboard size guide in the description. Keep in mind, sticking with a more common layout is going to make it easier to find compatible parts. Next, there's the matter of soldering versus hot swapping switches. If you're new to the mechanical keyboard scene or don't feel comfortable soldering, I definitely recommend hot swap. This makes it far easier to replace switches if you decide to change things up later. It's still possible to bend or break pins if you aren't careful though, so be sure to order a few extra. Many PCBs also support RGB or single color lighting. As I'll explain in a moment, deciding to implement lighting may influence the switch and keycap decisions you make later. Backplates are usually selected alongside PCBs as the key sizes and spacing need to match perfectly. This kit came with an aluminum backplate already attached to the PCB, with a thick piece of pour-on foam sandwiched between them. The foam reduces rattling and other unwanted noises and improves the overall typing feel. The backplate also came with foam padding under the spacebar as well. While uncommon, wireless connectivity is also a consideration. This will involve implementing a battery and may require some additional work when it comes to configuring the firmware. We're not going to get that far down the rabbit hole in this video, but the EC66 I was sent supports both Bluetooth 5.0 and 2.4 GHz wireless via an included dongle. It also has a 2200 mAh battery pre-installed in the bottom of the case. Once you've settled on a PCB and backplate, you'll need to find a shell or a case to call them home. If you're buying these separately and not part of a kit, you'll need to perform some due diligence to ensure the PCB and backplate and case will all be physically compatible. The case composition can vary from common materials like plastic and aluminum to something more exotic like wood. Some cases even have a thick block of metal embedded in the base to provide some added heft. The mounting style is effectively how the case and internals are assembled together. This particular example is a gasket mount design. The top and bottom pieces squeeze together and hold the plate with rubberized grips. More pour-on foam can be added to the bottom of the case to provide additional padding. Assembling and disassembling this particular board was incredibly easy, as there's not a single screw involved. It's not a bad idea to pick up a custom keyboard toolkit. This one from RunJRX includes a keycap puller, switch puller, claw grabber, tweezers, aluminum switch opener, GPL 205 grade 0 lubricant, and two lubrication brushes. While this toolkit isn't required, it definitely speeds up the process. Switches are what give a custom keyboard most of its personality. In the last few years, there's been a massive influx of switch designs from seemingly infinite manufacturers. These switch designs have varying actuation forces, travel distance, sounds, and tactility. Switches can also be expensive, so it's not a bad idea to test out a few styles before making a final decision. While having a full board of switches just to test isn't exactly practical, having a few samples can at least help determine what type you're into. This tester kit has an acrylic base and comes preloaded with 9 Cherry MX switches, 3 linear, 3 tactile, and 3 clicky. It also includes a keycap puller and 2 variations of O-rings. O-rings help silence keystrokes and reduce the travel distance. They come in different hardness and thickness variations to provide the desired sound and feel. In addition to helping determine which switch type to get, the tester kit also makes for a satisfying desk toy. The clear keycaps make it easy to tell which type of switch is installed, but they can also be removed and replaced with other switch designs. This 18-piece switch sample pack from Glorious provides a spectrum of options from manufacturers like Gateron, Kale, and Glorious. They even included a couple lubricated and non-lubricated samples for comparison. The switches Eclipse Team sent me are Gateron Yellow Pros. They're a linear switch that promise to be smoother, quieter, and more consistent than Cherry MX Reds. They also come well lubed from the factory. Lube improves the consistency of a switch and helps conceal unwanted scratching or scraping. The feel of a switch can be significantly altered by adding lube, so if you're going to do this yourself, it's important to practice restraint and research what impact lube will have on your desired switch type. Some switches come with lube pre-applied, but most enthusiasts insist on doing it themselves. The components outlined in the toolkit I mentioned make doing this yourself significantly easier. I'm not going to explore techniques in this video, but generally a very thin layer is all that's needed on the inner components and the spring. If you want to watch a detailed video on switch lube best practices, I've included a link in the description. As I mentioned, if you decide to integrate lighting into your custom keyboard, this will also influence your choice in switches. Most modern switches include something called an SMD window. This slit allows light from the PCB to make its way through the switch. Some switches even have transparent tops to allow the light to be diffused around the keycap. While most keys need only a switch, particularly wide keys also require a pair of stabilizers. Without a stabilizer, pressing on the edge of a wide key would cause it to lower unevenly. Stabilizers connect to the keycap using the same cross-pattern design that most switches do. They're attached together using a metal arm that helps them raise and lower in unison. Since they contain moving parts, many people choose to lubricate them as well. These stabilizers on the EC66 came pre-lubed. Keycaps are incredibly easy to change and provide a significant visual impact. Assuming your board uses cherry-style stems, keycaps are just about universal. Because of this, keycap sizes aren't usually measured in millimeters or inches. Instead, they just use a unit measurement, or U. A standard alphanumeric key is typically 1U deep and 1U wide. All other keys are sized accordingly. While just about all keyboards follow this metric, there are some obscure layouts that require non-standard keycap lengths. Bottom line is, the more common your layout, the easier it's going to be finding replacement keycaps. But this only covers the horizontal sizing of keycaps. The vertical size and shape are referred to as the profile. Some keycaps tilt away from the user on the bottom rows, while others are entirely uniform. Some have a noticeable curvature when looked at head-on, while others are completely flat. As far as I'm aware, there aren't significant advantages to any of these differences. It's more what feels right to you. Another variable that could affect keycap feel is the material. While keycaps can be made of any number of thermoplastics, ABS and PBT are the two most common. ABS is generally cheaper and more widely available. However, it also has a tendency to develop a glossy shine with consistent use. PBT is considered a higher quality material that doesn't degrade with use the way ABS can. However, some PBTs have been known to warp with time. Instead of having legends printed on them, quality keycaps are double shot to ensure legends are sharp and don't ever wear off. If the legend piece is transparent, this also allows light to shine through for better legibility in the dark. The keycap material can not only affect the way the board feels, but also the way it sounds. The thicker walls of PBT keycaps provide a deeper thock noise, while lighter ABS keycaps provide more of a clack sound. These keycaps sent to me by Eclipse Team are made of a nice set of PBTs with an MDA profile. Some keyboards also have media controls or a volume wheel. The EC66 came with a red aluminum button dial for programmable controls, but they sell other colors as well. While many OEMs will use a non-detachable USB connection, most modern DIY keyboards just have a USB-C port. This provides the user flexibility to experiment with different cable styles, lengths, connectors, and colors. While just about any USB-C to USB cable would work just fine, the cable provides the user with yet another opportunity to personalize their device. Eclipse Team sent me two coiled USB-C to USB cables with aviator connectors. One has white paracord, TechFlex, and accents, while the other has red paracord with black TechFlex and accents. These cables are available in a select number of configurations, but there are boutique cable makers out there that can design basically anything to fit your style. Some folks even make their own cables from scratch, but we're not going to get that granular today. Suffice it to say, there are a lot of possibilities out there. And with the cable connected, the keyboard is officially complete. While this is more of a how-to video than a full keyboard review, I'll take a moment to acknowledge that the EC66 is actually a really great 65% board. The RGB lighting is vibrant and has several pre-configured effects. While the light doesn't shine through these particular keycap legends, the clear switch tops and white backplate diffuse the lighting evenly around the keys. Much of the typing feel comes from the switches, but everything from the keycap texture and ergonomic profile to the generous pour-on foam placement help contribute to a truly cathartic typing experience. I did notice that the spacebar has a much clackier sound than the more muted alphanumeric keys. Maybe this is fine for some people, but I would have preferred a more consistent noise all around. I'm normally a tactile switch kind of guy, but this is one of the best sounding and feeling linear keyboards I've ever tested. Take a listen. I have to say, there's a lot more to building a custom keyboard than I originally thought. I didn't realize how much research I was signing up for when I accepted this project. Hopefully this gives you some insight into the basics of building a keyboard yourself. I'm very new to this space, so if I left anything out or I said something incorrect, please elucidate in the comment section below. I think the keyboard came out great, and I'm glad I had the opportunity to learn a little bit more about the expansive world of DIY mechanical keyboards. Special thanks to Eclipse Team for supplying the hardware for this review. Links to their products can be found in the video description, and down there you will also find affiliate links to all other products I mentioned, links to buy these shirts from Retro Rifle, and links to the resources I used to learn about building custom keyboards. If you enjoyed this video, you'll probably like one of these other keyboard reviews as well. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one.